So the writer creates the script, and the average comic book these days is 20 to 22 pages. So that's the beginning of the process.
Does anybody remember Aquamaria from the cartoon? From Static Shock? She was like a Spanish girl with the powers.
Wait, 22 pages?
Yeah.
How many pages is this
comic? But she was, there was an important reason why I decided not to, I mean, to tell the truth,
pages.
When a writer decides, he has to kind of pass it through the thing. But I was kind of sneaky back then, so that was kind of the way I was.
Right.
Yeah,
so Ivan would do all these unexpected things with characters.
Yeah.
But the stories were cool, the fans loved them, so it's like, okay, what are we going to do? You know, so basically, the editor is at the beginning of the process. So the editor has to work with all the creators to make the book. So if I'm the editor of a book, I talk with the writer writes the script, we go through the script, and we say, okay, maybe this needs to be changed, or maybe this needs to be changed, or maybe everything is fine. And then the next thing is, once that script is approved, that script is given to the penciler.
Right.
Now, usually with the art, there are four different parts of the process. There's the penciler, who does the actual drawing. So the penciler is responsible for breaking everything down into panels. Usually the script will say panel one, panel two, panel three, panel four. And then the penciler will take that and start drawing the story. Mm-hmm. Now, a writer usually gets 2 weeks to write a script. And then...
Sometimes less.
Sometimes 1 week.
Yeah.
And, you know, sometimes there'll have to be revisions, mm-hmm. so they'll have to go back and do a second draft.
Within the same week?
No, usually you get another week. You should get another week.
That's, you know... But we had a very tight deadline with Milestone, because one of the selling points of Milestone was that they made the deadline of the distribution.
Right.
So they always made it. So sometimes even if things had to be changed, you had to do it really quickly. So my turnaround rate, for me personally, since I was trying to do more than one book, because a writer can't really live on just one book. They have to kind of have a couple and juggle them. I was like a 4-day turnaround guy. That was my thing. I would do it in 4 days altogether and give another day for revisions. So hopefully that was my... And plus, I used to type really fast, so that kind of helped too. So guys, keep practicing typing.
Yep. So, that's true. So, then the penciler does the pencils. A penciler usually gets 4 weeks to do 20 to 22 pages. And usually gives them in every week. So maybe like 5 or 6 pages a week. The editor will go through the pencils with the penciler, see if any changes have to be made. There could be a variety of things. When Chris comes, he can talk more about that. Then once the pencils are approved, it goes to inks. So the inker is the person who takes, they usually use a brush, an ink brush. Sometimes they use something called a rapidograph, which is basically like a pen that ink constantly comes out of, and you use ink cartridges with it. So it's one of those two things, because the pencils as they are, if you try to reproduce them, they'll be gray, the same way that they look on your pages. But the line work has to be black, so it can reproduce and the images be sharp. So the inker has to take the ink and go over the pencils. But every part of the process elevates the artwork. So the inker is not just tracing the lines. That's not what the inker is doing. The inker should know how to draw, so the inker can add some weight and some dimension to the artwork. So sometimes make some lines thinner, sometimes make some lines thicker. This is Christine Gilliam here. Christine Gilliam helped run Milestone Comics. She was a nerve center.
Yeah.
So we're going to get to that. Christine was the first person I met at Milestone when I had to get interviewed to work for no money.
So she was there even before you.
That's
like
right.
Ground zero.
That's right. That's right. Then it goes to the colorist. The artwork is usually reduced because original art pages are like 11 by 17.
Right. What's the reason for that, guys? What do you think? Why is it big?
So like... put as much as possible, so when it's reduced, you don't lose too much.
In fact, when you reduce, it actually looks even more detailed, because it kind of shrinks everything a little bit.
But if you was to do it on an 8x11, you will lose more weight, because you might have to shrink it.
And people need kind of room to work.
Yep, it's true. So yeah, that's why it has to be larger. But once you get past the inking stage, and once the colorist has to do it, you don't want the coloring to be larger, because then when that compresses, the colors are going to be too rich, too concentrated, and the colorist is going to be doing detailed work that will get lost. So it has to be reduced to comic book size. Now, the way a lot of coloring is done these days is on the computer, digital coloring. So what will happen is the pages, once they're inked, they'll be scanned, and they'll be turned into digital files, and the colorists will use digital coloring techniques, painter programs, to color the pages. And then those pages, at the same time they're being colored, they're sent to the letterer. And the letterer is responsible for all of the caption boxes and word balloons.
Who's the letterer we use most of the time?
Oh man, I can't remember that dude's name. Pamiani was one of the inkers. Steve Dutro. That dude, I think he lettered all of the comics.
Really?
I swear. Like, you know when Christine could talk about this, because Christine, in addition to all the things that she did to run the business, you were seeing all the checks.
Yeah.
So this guy must have been getting like twenty checks a month.
But how much do you get paid for page? Remember, it's like a lower rate for
something like
letterers.
$20.
Yeah, so it's a lower rate. Colorists get a lower rate. The people who get the bigger rate are the penciler gets the biggest rate.
Yep.
And then the writer does get a rate, but way below the penciler, because writers are expected to write quicker.
Exactly.
Yeah. So we can actually knock them out more.
Right.
But I did so many books back then that.
You made some pretty good money.
That was good. That was good days.
And another thing is that, as a writer, your words and your storytelling really have to be good, because when someone goes to buy a comic, like, they don't even see your words. They see the art. That's the first thing they see. So the art has to get them to buy it, right? And then...
The writer's the guy who gets them to come back.
Exactly.
That's
the stories that compel you and say, okay, I care about what's going on with this character. I want to see what's happening with them next month. Because the thing about the Blood Syndicate is, the Blood Syndicate was kind of like a soap opera. It was kind of a mix between like gang stories and soap operas. Because there were all these like romances and these different stories.
Anybody ever see novellas at home? Or the family sees novellas? Well, you know, I was raised with novellas with my grandmother. So that was deep in there. It was like all that Spanish kind of like dripping kind of like, oh my God, what's going to happen next? I feel so terrible.
Yeah. So that's, but the first thing you see is the art. So in terms of the status of comic books, the art is usually the first thing. And like Ivan said, it takes longer, so that's why the pencilers get paid the most.
Sometimes it's you know, and depending on how the health of the penciler is, if I remember correctly, some pages came in really late, and you had to kind of like really hustle to get that thing out there.
Yeah,
the inker would have to go really fast.
Right.
So whenever you see an ink job that's kind of half-assed, kind of bad on the book, a lot of times it's because he had the book in the last minute, and he had to do it rushed, and he had to get his assistant on there, and just fill in blanks.
It's true.
Yeah.
And what this goes to is like responsibility. So every member of the process affects the person in back of them. So you have to be a professional. Like, comic books are like fun and people buy them, but it's a job. Comic books have to come out every month. You have to be a professional. So if you're late a week with your part of the process, that gives the person in back of you less time. And you may not care about that, because you're like, hey, I'm a week late, but so what? I'm the artist. I'm getting my paycheck, whatever. But like Ivan said, if the person in back of you has less time to do their best work, then the final product is not going to come out looking as good, which means the sales are going to go down, which means eventually it'll get canceled, and you thinking you're a big man, you don't have a book anymore. So everybody affects everybody else. So you're a team. You have to be a professional. Do your work on time.
Can I ask you a you, how did you get involved with Milestone, and how was your experience in the early days?
I was an administrative assistant at United Negro College Fund, and I dealt somewhat with entertainment over there. And I was interested in branching further into entertainment. So there was an opening at Milestone for office manager. So that's basically what I did at United Negro College Fund. So I transferred over to Milestone. I got a job there. And just helped them set up everything from the files in the beginning to help recruit people to answering phones to actually getting on the subway and running art to a inker from a penciler. Everything. So, I mean, from cleaning the place to just making sure the lights stayed on. And I actually went from office manager to director of corporate communications, where I did the public relations for the company. So there I would do press releases when we would have special stories and stuff come out and put that out to the press. And I wish I'd have brought my press book with me. We picked up a lot of press all over the world, like internationally, from these comic books.
If I remember correctly, one of the best things about coming into the office was seeing Christine. Because she was like the heart, you know? And it's like she, not only the heart, but she knew everything was going on. So if you thought you weren't getting the full story from somebody else, or like something's going on and no one wants to talk about it, Christine will give you at least a little facts about it so you can kind of guess what's going on. Plus, if you needed anything or your check was late or stuff like that, Christine was a go-to person. That was really nice. And this man over here, I mean, he I don't know how many complaints you heard from me. But he was also very good at listening to the artists complain, because, you know, artists and writers were like emotionally wrecked people. So we come in there and we always got some issue going on. So he would hear all of that. He kind of really good at calming people down and getting stuff forward.
Tried my best. I mean, we all have complaints. It's a job, but, you know, to connect it up, I first started working at Milestone because I had gotten fired from a job and I wasn't making any money at the time, and I went into a newsstand and I saw an Icon comic book and a Hardware comic book. And, you know, I was raised on Spider-Man, Batman, X-Men, so to see these comic books with black characters, I was like, okay, I want to know what this is. But I couldn't afford to buy any because I didn't have a job. So a guy I knew was actually interning at Milestone, and he was telling me about it. And I was like, is it paying? He said, no. I was like, I don't want to do that. I need money. So then no job came up, and I said, okay, well, I want to be a comic book writer. So, and I would like to start my own company. So I said, well, the only way I'm going to do that is I'm going to have to get knowledge. And right now, this is the only opportunity. So I saw an ad in a catalog, and it said, for people who want to, you know, be interns, call this phone number. So I called, and Christine picked up the phone, and she set up an appointment for me to meet one of the founders, Dwayne McDuffie, and a guy named Matt Wayne, right? So I go into office, and Christine is the first person I meet, and she takes me to Dwayne and Matt's office, because they shared an office. And I'm there, and Matt is talking, and Dwayne is just sitting behind his desk looking at me, not saying a word. So I'm like really nervous. I'm like,
Dwayne
and first
is a big
off,
guy.
And
Dwayne
first off,
bigger than me. He's like really good. He has his face that kind of looks. He can look very happy sometimes, but sometimes he'll give you that stare. Like,
yeah. And that was all I got. And the thing is, you know, Milestone, black characters, black owned, and this guy Matt was white. So now I'm cool. That has nothing to do with nothing. But I'm kind of like, okay. So I'm standing there at the door, and the white guy is talking to me, and the black guy is just looking at me. So I'm kind of nervous. So then at the end of the interview, I don't know what's going on. And then they said, okay, you know, you could start with us, I guess, like, you know, next week or something like that. So I started, and I'm thinking, okay, I'm going to be dealing with all the writers and artists and all that stuff and learn how these comics were made. Nope. They had me, like, filing stuff, dealing with mailing labels. My second day, they said, hey, we have all these Milestone cups that we need to send out to our business partners to say thanks for supporting Milestone. So we need them all to go in boxes and get mailed out. And I was like, okay, where are the boxes? And they were like, well, there are no boxes. You have to create the boxes. So they gave me all these cardboard sheets and an X-Acto knife and a pair of scissors and some tape and said, okay, now you gotta make the boxes. So I have to measure the cup and then figure out how to make a box and make these boxes. pack all these cups up, and that was it. So I'm doing all this menial stuff for like 3 months, making photocopies, but I'm getting to meet like the artists and the writers and everybody.
He's making you a man.
And then like, exactly.
Well-rounded.
Exactly. So then like after the end of the 3 months, I went to the president's office one day. His name was Derek. He was a president of the company. He now works at Black Enterprise. He's a number three person at Black Enterprise magazine, and he actually was at Black Enterprise before Milestone. Mm-hmm. And so I said, hey, I really like working for you guys, but I'm actually losing money working here, so I need to go someplace that's gonna pay me money. And so then, later on that day, they offered me a part-time job. You know, because basically they were like, okay, this guy is a hard worker, he loves this stuff, and he's a professional. He gets in on time, he works, sometimes he stays late, but he's serious. So that's the thing, like, you have to be serious. So it went from a part-time job to a full-time job, and I started in the business area, and Christine and I were working more closely together under Derek. So that way I could see how a company was run, how Milestone gets its money from its different clients, how that money is distributed, accounting, the ordering of supplies, basically everything that allows a company to run so it can hire and pay creative talent. Before there can be Beats by Dr. Dre, Beats by Dr. Dre has to be a corporation with legal documents, it has to have an address, and it has to have a bank account.
Check out this beautiful milestone jacket.
Yeah, that's right.
We all got one. It was so cool. Oh my God, so
y'all
cool.
All have a milestone jacket? Oh, I was going to say, that's impossible. Yeah, we all had a milestone
jacket. I had a training card.
We got it. We got placement on Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. If you look at old episodes of Fresh Prince, you'll see in Carlton's bedroom, you'll see this jacket hanging on the wall. You'll see all four of the titles, posters on the wall frame, like we had large posters. So that was also part of my job, like getting the word out about us. We also had placement on Roseanne. We had a milestone some kind of sticker we had, and they had that on the refrigerator in the house. So just getting the logos and getting the icons out there.
That's how you know something's valid, when you see it on TV, right? And that's really important. I mean, even putting the newspapers, the thing about Milestone that I always had, the problem was this, we didn't get enough advertising on the radio, we have like local advertising.
Yeah,
right.
We did most things through the free stuff through press just picking up who we were and being interested in a new multicultural comic company started by four black guys. So that was like a big catch to bring people in and say, what's going on over here? And then we were distributed by DC Comics, so that was big. And I got to Milestone, I was never into comics, except for growing up as a little girl, I read like the Archies.
So
that was the extent of my foray into comics until I got to Milestone. So I really like knew nothing about it and wasn't really interested in it. But once I started like on the business side, and then I had to learn what all the different jobs were and what everyone did, it sparked my interest. And then I got to understand, like, I always thought comics were for kids. And then as I started reading the stories, you know, and I saw like what went into it, I would be a part of like the brainstorming meetings where we would sit around and think of different ideas about which way the stories were going to go and stuff. And to see how smart these guys were and what they knew and what went into making these books was just like amazing to me. And so I went from, you know, comic books to like, what? Wow. And watching like the paste up work and the inkers and the colorists and stuff. It was so interesting to me, and I'm glad that I was able to be a part of it, and it definitely broadened my perspective in terms of what comic books are. I don't even think they should be called comic books. It's deceiving, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, these stories were just awesome. Blood Syndicate was definitely like my favorite. Not just saying that, it's you, but yeah, I like that whole...
Well, everyone had a favorite. Right?
Yeah. But the way that those stories were, they just made me like, what's next? Exactly, that novella feel.
And it was the most unique one because you never saw, like, gang members with superpowers.
Yeah, nothing was typical.
You know, but in a way they were similar to the X-Men in the sense of, like, the X-Men are a family, but you know how it is with your family. You always have issues with your family. Mm-hmm. If you see a family that's all getting along, there's always issues within the family. So with the Blood Syndicate, there were, like, always issues. And when you're dealing with a gang, it's about, well, okay, if you're the leader, then I have to believe in your leadership. And if I don't believe in your leadership, then I'm going to challenge it. You know, so there were always like those kind of conflicts of authority, you know. So that's what really made this comic unique among any other teen comic, Justice League, X-Men, Fantastic Four, anything like that.
But what I think what was really good about the company was that it was like an education for people working there, because, you know, I thought I had my issues down. I thought I had to know everything about, you know, oh, society's doing this, blah, 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 and that. But then, you know, it made you look at your own kind of like your bigotry, your old prejudices inside of you. And the stuff you don't know about, like I had this character, Kwai, which, you know, she's my baby. But she's coming from my love, you know, from the Kung Fu movies, the karate stuff, right? And, you know, she had these powers, and she was really beautiful, and she had this thing, she had, like, cloth that would fly. But then I realized, you know, someone sent her a letter saying, well, you know, this is a stereotype, blah, 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 blah. You know? And I was looking at it and saying, you know something, part of that is true. It's like, the image I see is the ones I see from the movies. And I don't really, I didn't really have any Asian friends, and... You know, I got to go in there, and I started playing with it, that kind of thing. Because there's a lot of prejudice in there. Even Boogeyman had issues.
Right.
Because I modeled him after Mouse. And, you know, the character about the Holocaust?
Mm-hmm. Ah, right.
So that was kind of the end joke about him. Well, he's a Jewish kid, this and that, and he doesn't feel good about himself, you know, the whole vermin thing in the back of his head.
Right.
But if you don't do it right, they're going to think you're making fun of Jewish people and calling them rats, that kind of stuff. So you have to be really careful and kind of make sure. Even the epilepsy thing, remember we did the epilepsy with Brick House?
I remember, yep, that's right.
Brick House, the character, she's a big brick character, right? And she has epilepsy. And part of the thing was she would have like an earthquake, like they would call it a brickquake, when she would have a seizure. So people wrote in saying, you did the right thing, you did the right way. And I was like, I didn't even know that, because, you know, you're supposed to, when a person has a seizure, my best friend in the world has this, and you're supposed to not go crazy, but calm down, don't put anything in the mouth, don't shove anything in the mouth, just kind of calm them down, just kind of hold them until they get through it. So that's what the character did, and I just didn't know that was important, and now more people know how to do it because they see it.
Exactly.
So what was your best and worst moment in Milestone?
You first.
My best. I used to like the conventions. Like the comic conventions, and then also I think even more so like the Black Expo conventions, because it wasn't conventional comic book fans there. It was, we were turning so many new people onto it, and it was just exciting seeing people come through and like how crazy it would get around us. Like, you know, it was really like a fan thing. When we did Black Expo in New York, and Method Man came through there.
Right.
I think I still have a picture of him. And he
Anybody
really
know Method
loved,
Man?
Yeah. And he loved the comic books, and he came over, and, you know, like, everybody's coming. So just watching, like, new people get turned on to it, I guess, because I was a new person to it, so watching them get that was probably, like, some of my best moments, traveling and watching the fans. My worst moment was then. Yeah, was the end when we broke down, and, you know, we went from a bigger company to a little smaller company, and then, but I had to say goodbye.
No.
Yeah, that was sad. But it was nice to have, you know, all the people that came through my life because of Milestone and the different things that we did. I mean, we used to do stuff like we actually went to Great Adventure, like
that's
the whole
right.
staff, you
that's
know.
Right.
Went to the, we would go to the movies together and stuff like that, you know, so it became almost like a family also with the, so. A lot of good times there. Yeah, I had fun also, like, as the, when I went to the corporate communications part, we wanted to expand the base, of course. That was always, you know, our thing, to expand our audience, and I was able to work out a deal with, I don't know if you guys remember, the Lost Boys, Mr. Cheeks, and rappers from, they were, maybe like in the 90s, they were popular. And we did a crossover comic book with them with Static, so they were a rap group. And so we brought them into the storyline to, like, get more of that audience that wasn't typically into comic books, you know, into it. So doing that crossover project was fun.
And Milestone was the first, I think, comic book company to do that. Like, in later years, like, you would see, like Marvel doing, like, Eminem and The Punisher and something like that. But Milestone did that first. Because, quite frankly, you know, and it's still the same way. A lot of the people, like at Marvel and DC and these companies, like, they're not up on hip-hop and stuff like that. They're not up on that kind of pop culture. So, like, you know, Milestone, we had so many people of color there. We were coming from so many different backgrounds that we knew what was up. So the offices were big. And you would walk into those offices, and in any given room, like, you would hear, like, rap music booming. And that's what people were, like, doing their work to. You know, you would hear, like, I mean, you would hear, like, Wu-Tang Clan. You would hear, like, Diddy, Biggie, any of that stuff going. So
that was some good energy.
Like, we were immersed in that stuff. Wow, you know, going to that, I mean, I guess my best moment at Milestone was probably, I remember, I think it was 1994, the universe had expanded from 4 books to 7 books. And it was called the Shadow War. And it was this big event that Milestone did, and the sales of the books really increased. And so I think it was at the end of the year, we all got bonus checks, and we all got gifts, and I got a backpack, which I really needed, because I needed a new backpack, and this and that. But that was kind of like the peak of the company, as you know, as far as I remember. So that was really cool, and you know, everyone really felt good about it. We were really a good, solid team. Worst, I don't know. Okay, worst would probably be, as Christine said, the company went from a bigger company to a smaller company. And one of the reasons that happened, we'll talk about this, Ivan may have talked about this previously, a comic book called Static. There was an issue of Static. Static had this girlfriend.
I killed Static.
Daisy, right? Now you didn't. No, you didn't kill Static. And so, you know, like, Virgil and Daisy decided to take their relationship to the next level. And so, you know, you have to be really careful about how you handle a subject like that. So we had the cover, and the cover had, you know, Daisy and Virgil on the couch, and they were kissing, and, you know, nothing all, like, racy, nothing like that.
But we did change that, remember?
Yeah.
Because it was first, Sack was a bit too aggressive, and Daisy was kind of like, oh.
Right, so right.
We didn't want that message of a girl being, like, apprehensive, forced into it, you know? So we try to make that.
Yeah, kind of like where they're both emotionally, and equally as powerful.
Yeah.
It's not like the boy dominating the girl or anything like that. So we did the cover, and Milestone had a publishing deal with DC Comics. So Milestone made all the content, and DC were the ones that actually paid for the printing and distributed the comics in the different comic book stores. So they thought that cover was a bit too mature, and they were unwilling to do the book with that cover. So we ended up having to come up with a solution where it was a black cover, and in the center of the cover was a heart, like, cut out, and you saw the faces of the two characters kissing. And then if you opened the book, it had a second cover, and the second cover was that, was the original shot of them on the couch. And one of the people who ran the company, he felt like that was censorship, because Milestone was responsible for all of its content, and the subject matter was handled respectfully. And so because of that, he fought against that. And DC said, okay, well, you know, we're the ones that print and publish the comics, so since you have something to say about it, now we're gonna start reducing your organization. Now, you talked about, some of you want to start a business, right? Okay, so this is very important. I guess you have to understand, if you are working with different partners, you know, I guess, what are the rules, what you can and cannot do, but what you want to aspire for is control of your own ideas and control of your own product. That's really important. If you're working with partners in business, that's fine, but you're doing that so you can elevate to the point where you can have control of your own product. It's just like in music. The big thing in music is who owns the publishing rights to that music. And what you do is, in the beginning, you make music for others, so eventually you can accumulate enough money and enough popularity, and you start your own label, start your own company, and in that company, you control that. If you look at Dr. Dre, if you look at Diddy,
Yo, Wayne.
If you look at Jay-Z, you look at the people, Russell Simmons, the people who really became successful, they may have started out doing things for others, but once they gained enough money and enough power, they created a business where they could do whatever they want. But the thing about Milestone was that the people who started Milestone believed in the characters and the ideas so much that they fought for what they believed in at the risk of what happened. Now that's another thing. At a certain point, the kind of stuff you do, your art, your business, it has to represent what you believe in, and sometimes you're going to be challenged. And your integrity is based upon standing up for what you believe in instead of always backing down. Because if you back down once, people are going to keep pushing you, backing you down again. So you have to know when to be willing to compromise and when you have to be willing to stand your ground.
Thing is that after that happened, he was asked to was he asked?
Basically what they said was that if he did not
step down
from his position, that they were gonna stop publishing the comics altogether. So he had to do that. He had to take a back seat, and he did that for the good of the company. And that's another thing. You can't let your ego come before the people you work for, because those people have livelihoods, they have kids, they have jobs. So you can't say like, well, I'm not gonna step back because this is my role at the company. Because if you do that, all these people lose your jobs. So if you're starting a company and you have people that work for you, you have a responsibility to them. And the responsibility to them at times is going to come before your responsibility to yourself. That's part of what being a leader is.
Right. But after that happened, it seemed that was the point that kind of Milestone started crumbling a little bit. Like, things started getting bad.
Right.
Which I feel sad about, because I remember that when we introduced ourselves to DC Comics, to the newspaper, and we had to write that stuff, there was always kind of an air of, like, it felt like, who do you think you are? It felt like, you know, you were saying you had this mission, but what are you trying to say, that we didn't fulfill the mission before, that kind of stuff. So after that happened, it just felt like everybody was getting stressed about it, and then all our own issues started popping up. I mean, I would say I had so many issues pop up after that, and things was just getting worse for me on my own personal level, that things just started crumbling.
I mean, we're all human beings, yeah. So I had mine too. I mean, the thing about Milestone for me, in addition to me liking comics and me wanting to see black characters, is the men were kind of like, you know, like big brothers. I don't have any brothers. My father died when I was 10 years old. So they were kind of like these examples. So when you're working for them, you admire them in that way. And when you see them arguing, it's kind of like your family is arguing. And the same way that you may have issues with your bigger brothers, you know, you're a human being. So I had them too. We're all people. But again, I think in the end, you know, we all still manage to stay together and stay loyal to each other, which is why we can still come and talk to you now. And these characters are still around. Some of these characters still appear in DC Comics. So even though the company went away, all of these ideas are still around. And if you watch Young Justice, you will see some of these Milestone characters in Young Justice. So that means now they're in cartoons. So it's not just people seeing them here, it's people seeing them all over the world in different languages, on cartoons.
And Milestone's work did influence comics. I mean, we did actually, there are more characters of color because of us. There are more characters who are gay and lesbian in the books because of us. There are more characters who are Latino, who are of age, different ages, all kinds of different things because of the work we did. There's always the people who break the ground that don't get the paychecks, right?
Right.
This is Jackie Ching.
Hi, I'm sorry I'm late. I'm like Rocket. I couldn't fly over traffic or get a parking spot, a legal parking spot.
I'm shaking your mind.
Yeah.
I don't know if you've covered this, but Joe and I were in editorial. We were editors, so it sounds like you were covering the macro. You know, the relationship with DC.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I did some of the personal roles as well, but I didn't really go full extent into what an editor did. I started along that, but if you want to talk about any personal
things that you had.
Also, remember, you wrote some of the stories as well.
I thought that, you know, a lot of you probably are interested in comics because you want to write and draw. You probably do it already. So just to tell you, another important role is the editor. Because I know Joe must have talked about it, but, and nudge me if I'm repeating you, but I just wanted to say that Dwayne was, Dwayne McDuffie was a very strong editor. And beneath him were, you know, Matt Wayne, his, what was he?
Well, yeah, no, our associate editor.
Okay, associate editor.
Not quite a strong editor.
Yeah, and then there are us, you know, and we came up from scratch. And thing is, there are different artists. Some are very insistent on keeping the work as is, but it's not, it's a team effort.
Yeah, team.
And you have to be a team player. So there are artists. Dwayne had all levels of artists, creators. Some of them were might have done something for Marvel or DC already, and they didn't want to be told you have to redraw. You know, but really, it's you know, the editor maintains the vision, right? The editor knows what's coming down in the storyline. The editor knows, you know, the characters probably best. They know whether they would do this. Like one time I was very angry with Dwayne because I wrote a story about how Static would try to save someone's life by pulling out a defibrillator from the wall, you know, like, you know, the, to charge up your heart. And, you know, like an ER. And Dwayne said, no, he don't take that out. And that was my big finale. I'm like, you can't take that away. But, you know, he didn't want Static to seem sort of reckless, because if he did, he's not a medically trained professional, so he wouldn't use his device, was Dwayne's argument. And so I took it out, because I'm a team player. But when there were artists and writers who did not want to listen to suggestion. They would go to Dwayne because he...
I was very guilty of that. I'm sorry.
No, I wasn't talking about you.
But it's true. Right?
I'm not. I wasn't talking about
you. I think it's so tight.
No, really, I wasn't. Dwayne, you know, it was his vision from the beginning, and he, although he had the ability to also let us, everybody, have input, that is such a mark of a great leader.
Yeah.
I mean, it must be hard when you create something and then you let people work on it and goes in directions you never intended. Back to working with strong artistic temperaments. You know, Dwayne would handle those mainly. And then he also, in order to keep a monthly schedule, you can't just work on the current issue. You have to have issues for the future. So if you were sending the October issue, say it's July, and you're sending the October issue to the printer, it takes a couple months before it can hit the newsstands. So Dwayne, well, everybody in the editorial had to commission backup stories. So I don't know, who reads comics here? Do you ever like read a story and you're like, What happened before?
Yes.
That's a backup story, probably, just to catch up on time. Usually you have more than one team. You have to get ahead as far as possible. Because things happen, like what if an artist broke their hand? You can't just have that issue going to press. You have to have something in the drawer. And so, you know, and actually those backup issues started a lot of careers. Like Dwayne would let artists who had never worked before, including my husband, Prentice Rollins,
Wilfred
Santiago, Jamal Eichel.
Yeah.
Anyway, so these artists, Dwayne gave a lot of young people a chance. You know what? You know, the company, Milestone, gave a lot of young people a chance. And they were able to work on their first issues ever, and they would have time to perfect it because those are not the current issues. You know, they're for down the road, for backup. And those were in the drawer so that when we needed them, they'd be ready to go.
But if I remember correctly, whenever a backup story would happen, the readers would get really pissed. Because
they
know it was out of sync. It was out of sync. Something's wrong. The art's not quite the same. There's something. Sometimes the continuity is a little different. It's like, wait a minute, this person's not there anymore. Why isn't there? That kind of thing. So it was hard to. And they used to do that in X-Men all the time when they were doing the big Phoenix stuff. And all of a sudden you get like the Jim Lee story. Like, yeah, what is this? It's like, and you get pissed off. So people get angry about that, and that's a risk you have to take. And that's why people have to really get on time with their stuff. I used to get mad too. We were doing a big Bus Syndicate story, and we have to go to the club, and it's a White Roach story, right?
Yeah, I remember that.
And I remember Chris has a phobia of roaches, which I didn't know. You know. Chris Cross was a big, you know, he was a big artist, and he's supposed to be here, but he's probably not gonna make it. Probably. He has a phobia, so we had to get somebody else, somebody who was a seasoned professional, but the person really drew them very 60s style, and like.
Very
blocky.
Yeah.
And I was so upset. It's like, oh my God, my flow is gone. And that's when sometimes a writer takes way too much, way too much worry about the book. Sometimes it gets you crazy and it causes a lot of trouble later on. You have to let it go. And so, well, we just make it up next time. But it happens.
Although part of what makes you a good artist or writer or colorist or letterer is that you care about the stuff. If you're a writer, you care about the stories. Going to Jackie's point about artists and changes, someone has a Blood Syndicate with Superman there. Would you be willing to pass that? I'll tell you a quick story about that. And here, I'm gonna give back this issue.
We waxed Superman.
And then we're gonna get to you.
Now, I remember this cover. You have Superman, and he's holding up this rock because he's gonna throw at the Blood Syndicate, right? So when Chris Cross originally drew it, you know, in the real world, if you're standing under a big rock, it's gonna cast a big shadow. Mm-hmm. So there was like a big Man. Shadow, and you kind of saw Superman's outline, and you saw the S, which
beautiful.
You didn't see Superman's face or anything. And I believe it was Dwayne. Dwayne said, no, you can't do that. Dwayne was like, because this is the cover of the comic book. This is gonna sell the comic book. Superman is in a Milestone comic book. You have to show all of Superman. And the artist was like, yeah, but he's under a rock. And he's like, that doesn't matter. Like, sometimes you have to break a rule to achieve something bigger. And the point was, we wanted to sell as many copies of this comic book as possible. So the shadow was taken away, and this was one of the best-selling issues of the series, because you see Superman, he's visible. So that means people...
I never got the royalties.
People who didn't even know Milestone Comics saw Superman and picked this
up.
And then learned about the Blood Syndicate as a result, and learned about Milestone Comics as a result. So that's an example of, you know, an artist probably doesn't want to change something, but Dwayne putting his foot down and saying you have to change it, and there's a good reason for it. So sometimes you have to make certain decisions in the interest of bringing more customers, more readers, more buyers to your material.
Now, when I worked in Marvel, when I started doing Ghost Rider, right, I kind of left Milestone and went over there. It was a totally different vibe there. It's like they didn't care. So it's like, okay, you got the story, but that's it. You get your check. See you later. Right. So it was the kind of thing, it was like, wait a minute, why is the colorist coloring the woman with blonde hair when she's been a brunette since 1984?
Yeah.
You know, why is the mother like 19 years old all of a sudden? Why does she have a halter top? What's going on here? And all this kind of stuff that if I just go into a Milestone and say, yeah, you're right, and they kind of like work on it, they didn't give a crap. So it's like, well, you know, the book's late, so we have to get it through next time maybe. And it was very frustrating because it was like the real world, right? And this is Milestone was very different. It was like a family. You go in there, you felt like you were part of the works. You know, you were part of the machine. Man, you don't know the impression I got. Marvel was like one of the worst experiences I've had in the comics industry, but Milestone was totally the best. Okay. Do you guys have any questions for us?
Yeah. Then wait. Hold on. With that sorry. Young man.
Can an editor change your story so that it completely goes against the point you go across?
Yep, absolutely. Absolutely.
So what can you do about it?
As a writer, well, there has to be an agreement. There has to be, if what you're writing works with what the overall vision of the book is, then usually it'll work out. But if you're going in another direction because you're just being stubborn or you have an ego and you think, well, my idea is better, so I'm just going to write it my way, then the editor has to be more interested in the vision of the book versus what you want to do. So what you can do, the answer to that question is, you can talk with the editor, but once the editor makes a decision, you have to respect that, because it's just like any other business. But your editor will usually work with you.
Doesn't mean that sometimes the editor is not wrong. Sometimes the editor can be wrong. Like, if, let's say if the whole thing is like blonde hair, right? If it's miscolored wrong, and they just say, well, it's that. And editors can have issues with each other. And one of the last editors I had, I felt like there was just too many issues going on between us. So it was a very unhappy situation. But if you get to a place where you really respect the editor, then you can open up and listen, and let your ego kind of go to the back door, you know, because egos are a very dangerous thing in the comic book business, in any kind of business.
In a creative business.
Yeah.
Yep.
You have to kind of let it go. I mean, you need a big ego to get there, but you have to understand that your ego is not paying everybody's paycheck. Your ego is not putting food on everybody's table. You're part of a team, and your ego has to take it. Your ego has to sit next to their ego.
I got that from when I was reading Aquaman. Their editor
desperately
wanted.
Yeah, it's a manga.
It was a manga that teaches people how to make manga. Basically, there's this guy who was their editor, Mr. Mira. He desperately wanted to make their story manga into a gag comic. So he tried desperately to fit gags into every single space he could. But they didn't really want to make it a gag manga. They wanted it to stay a story manga because that was the best thing they could do. So basically, he also told them that their art wasn't very suited for gags at all. So he also told one of the artists to... I started too much.
What's the name of the book?
Bakuman.
That's the one of the lists that we have to check out. I was wondering, like, say you had a small job, like an intern or something, and you had like this character that you wanted to show the people so you can impress them and put them in their comics. Like, you have the whole history of the character planned out and everything. How would you show, what's the best way to convince the boss that you want to get that character in the comics?
God. Okay. That's interesting. I think that's your natural instinct. Like, okay, so let's say, because that did happen to me. Like, I tried to pitch all these different stories, and, you know, what I had to realize is, like, this is not my universe. Milestone is a universe that was created by other people, and you have to respect that. The same way you would respect if you were, you know, like interning at like LucasArts, where they make Star Wars comics, or if you were interning in the Batman department. If you want to write stories, what you have to learn is it's not about putting your characters in these stories, but it's learning to deal with these characters. And so what a lot of creative people do is before they get to write their own characters, they build their careers writing other characters. So, for example, I'm trying to think of like a really good one. Okay, y'all know The Walking Dead?
Yeah, that was
okay. So The Walking Dead was created by a guy named Robert Kirkman. Now, Robert Kirkman, He actually started his career doing The Walking Dead, but for a while, he was doing a lot of work in Marvel Comics. He was writing, you know, X-Men. And that made him more popular because, you know, Walking Dead probably only sold 5,000, but X-Men probably sold like 75,000.
In the beginning, it sold 5,000.
Right? So that way, people who were reading his work on X-Men would eventually come and buy more Walking Dead comics. And because of his time on X-Men, he probably became a better writer. And so eventually, when Hollywood saw that comic and they saw all these great stories, and as you know about Walking Dead, it's not about the zombies, it's about the characters. So he was able to take his experience writing characters he did not own, X-Men, and bring that and make his own stories better and make his book better, and eventually that's what led to it being a TV show, which that it was just that good. So he didn't go into X-Men and say, hey, I have this cool character who would make a great new member of the X-Men. That's not what he did. Those are the X-Men, that's the team, you write those characters. So what I would say is, you know, you learn to be a better writer, and you start off writing other people's ideas, and then you can write your own, unless you don't want to do that, and then you just really stay the course and say, okay, while I'm working for these people, that's what I do. On my own, I will do my own comic.
Remember that there's a reason you're an intern. You're there to learn. If you bide your time and learn and take all that information, getting good, like Mr. Illich did, and start getting power on your own, then you keep those characters and you can make them better and better on your own time, right? And then when you see an opportunity, you maybe give it a character. But be careful with that, because remember that you're your characters,
right,
you want to have power on it. Because I had a character quiet, you know? Even like with Maria, these characters I created, they're not mine anymore. They belong to somebody else. And, you know, even though if Aquarius was on cartoons, I didn't get paid for that. And now there's all this kind of stuff where they're like, well, you know, it was really, you have to worry about that. But once, and right now with the internet, with all the web stuff you can do, all the software you can just get on your own computer, you can create your own stuff and make it nice and polished and copyright it on your own.
Right.
And that way you own it, because a lot of people, you know, we have a writer, Bob Washington, who's very angry about the industry right now because of some of the experience he had where he was the first writer on the Saturday. And a lot of his stuff was used on the cartoon, but he never got a penny off of it, you know?
And that's real, because look at all the Marvel and DC movies out now. Y'all know about the Ghost Rider film, right?
Yeah.
The guy who created Ghost Rider, you know, hearing about, well, they made this first film that made $100 million, and then the second film is coming out, he tried to sue Marvel to get some money. But at the time, he signed a contract that gave Marvel rights to Ghost Rider. Now, Marvel is now owned by Disney. So not only did he lose, but they said, they punished him, to be really honest about it. Because they were like, wow, well, through all the years that you went to conventions, you did Ghost Rider sketches, you made money off of those. Well, since you don't own Ghost Rider, that means you were doing things illegally. So you owe us $70,000 in back monies that you made over the years through drawing Ghost Rider.
But didn't he make it first?
Huh?
Didn't he make it first?
He created it, but he sold it to Marvel and he signed something called a work for hire contract, which means that my ideas are owned by you. So like,
you created it for me.
Yep. So like Ivan said, that's another reason why you don't want to create a character for the DC universe or the Marvel universe, because it'll appear in a comic book, but then they will own it afterwards.
Yeah, you can only do yourself a disservice by not understanding the legal aspect of your career.
Fine.
Understand what contracts you're signing. And I mean, my husband worked at Disney Animation, drawing for them in the office, and the entire time he was there, anything he created in the office belonged to Disney.
Yeah, so, I heard about that, because Disney owns anything that was drawn to those lines.
So anything.
Marvel was smart.
That took me away.
The voucher you assigned to get your check, on the back was the legalese saying they owned everything. So you couldn't even, that's the first thing, you put your signature on something and that's it, they owned it.
And you're going to definitely put your signature on the check.
Because you need
your money. You need your money.
You're not even going to dispute that right now.
You've got to have different categories in your brain. You're an intern.
Values.
Yeah, you're an intern. You're there to learn, to make your work better by talking to the artists there and the other artists,
and get your foot
learning,
in the door.
Getting your foot in the door. Yeah. Then you want to have something you for yourself that you would not sell. And then there's work for hire that you will sell and give up rights to so that you can build your name, build your reputation.
Because the bigger reputation you have, the more power you have to negotiate. Mm-hmm. And once you start, like Robert Kirkman right now, he's very big right now. He's got second deals going on.
He's huge.
One of the artists that he has a second deal with is
Sean.
Yeah. He has to work with Milestone all the time.
That's right.
Static.
That's right.
And he got his first work on.
He got his first work at Milestone, and now he's drawing the comic, which is created by the guy who created The Walking Dead.
And they're making a series out of it.
Yep. You have a question?
Yes, I do. Do you know what the best-selling and most successful comic book franchise is?
Now?
Yes, that's it.
It might be The Walking Dead. Absolutely. Yeah, I'm thinking that. Because the thing is, for all the Superman and Batman comics that are out now, and success is not even defined by how many comic books you sell. Because Walking Dead only sells like 15,000 comics a month. Although for an independent comic, that's really impressive. But the thing is, everyone knows what that is. The second season finale of that show brought in 9 million viewers. So I would say right now, Walking Dead is actually more successful than Superman.
It's also making a huge impact on society. You know, there's a lot more zombie stuff. Zombie video games for little kids.
That's it. So yeah, probably The Walking Dead. Although maybe for the next few weeks, Avengers.
Yeah.
we'll probably say that because we know the Avengers movie is gonna make $1 billion.
Oh my god, already.
It's already made over $500 million through overseas, and it just got to the United States. So probably for the next month, Avengers will be the most successful thing. But in general, I would say The Walking Dead.
Okay.
All right.
I have a question about like distributing advertising in general.
Okay.
How did you guys like have the advertising, the blood syndicate, all that? Like, how did you like market it, and how did you like aim it to the demographics that you wanted it to go to?
That's a great question. See, I think a lot of that was handled by DC because they did the actual marketing of it, because they had like right. Placement power and stuff. So they would do. We did a lot of the we did all the PR side, so like that's more like free marketing and advertising, where, like I said, I would do press releases and send them out to the press about the new titles coming out, you know, any new spins we put on stuff, and get that out there, and then they would come to us. So like MTV and all different stations, Vibe Magazine and Source and all that, they would come to us after reading our press releases. So that was actually a way of doing sort of like free promotion. And then we would do promotional items, like say these jackets and the t-shirts and the mugs and the trading cards and all the different paraphernalia and stuff that we came up with out of these, and get that stuff out there and do a lot of that as giveaways sometimes at different conventions and at, and like I said, and going to the conventions that were not necessary. So we do Comic-Con, but then we do Black Expo or, I don't know, something that's just not, that's not just comic fans, that's more of a general audience. So
we go to ABA?
ABA, right, the American Bookseller Association. So like I said, people who are not necessarily comic book fans, and exposing them to it, that works a lot.
It's very important to reach that audience that doesn't even touch a comic. Getting news on TV so that more people can see it. I remember we promoting artists, which was something that Milestone was very nice about, because they got me in the Times. I got like a New York Times article on a Sunday, which is a big thing back then.
Yeah.
And we were all over the Village Voice, and every time they talk about one of the artists, we were promoting Milestone, and that was a wonderful thing.
Yeah, so there's a lot of different levels which you can take it and take it to the people. And we utilize every one of them.
Yeah, I mean, basically, like advertising, of course, you have to pay for. You know, so, you know, if you have a company and you want to pay for advertising, I mean, because of the Milestone DC relationship, I don't know if Milestone had an actual advertising budget within DC. Outside of DC, like any press they might have wanted to get, you would have to make particular business arrangements. So advertising out the paper, distribution, it depends what you're distributing, but when it came to comic books, right now there is one distributor that distributes comic books to all the different comic book stores. Yeah.
Wow.
One distributor. That's it.
What distributor?
Wait, so what's DC?
At that day, there was like three. There was Diamond, there was Capital, and there was another one.
But then Marvel tried to do their own distribution, which kind of messed up a lot of the companies too.
Right. And there's two different types of distribution. There's distribution of the comic books, the single issue comic books, but then once you collect five or six of them into a hardcover book or a trade paperback, then that's a book. That can actually get into bookstores. So that's another kind of distribution. So when you have enough stories collected, when you have a book with a spine, you have distribution avenues that are not just limited to comic book stores. Also now you have digital distribution, you know,
online.
Through Apple and the iPad, online, you can make websites and distribute your own material. So it really depends on the type of product that you have, but distribution is crucial because you can make the best product, but if you cannot get it to your audience, you're lost.
How many people have DC app on their, or the Marvel app on their phone?
My boyfriend does.
Yeah,
so, I have a question.
I got it too, I haven't tried it yet, but you can actually read the books
really
online.
Yeah. I have a question.
And right now the bootleg thing is such a big thing that I have the entire Milestone lexicon, whatever.
Really?
I have the whole thing. Online.
Right, yeah, you can.
Yeah.
That person in the back, you haven't heard from.
Okay.
You know how you were talking about copywriting and all that? Can you tell us the first steps of copywriting?
Cool. You know the quick way to do it that they told me? I don't know if it's still real.
Mail it to yourself.
Mail it to yourself.
That's
right?
They call it the poor man's copyright.
That doesn't work.
Yeah.
But try it. Have it anyway.
Yeah, that's something to do,
yeah.
Like initially. You take your work and you put it in an envelope and you address it to yourself, from yourself.
And you never
put
open
a stamp on it. And you mail it, and it will come back to your house, and you never open that. So that way, because it's stamped by the post office, and that's a federal agency, it probably, like you said, won't stand up in like court of law, but it would be something to go towards your claim if you're claiming this is your work. So that's the initial way to do it. And then you can go online and check with the Library of Congress and get an application.
Right.
And
copyright.
I know I've written since Milestone, and I've copyrighted, I think it cost me like $20.
By the way, she's a great writer, and she's a great poet. And she has all these wonderful events and slams. If anybody loves poetry slamming, this is the queen of New York, right?
And
here.
You actually self-published a book, right?
I did.
You self-published
did.
A book of
and
your
I was missing my poems. Editors when I was missing my editors.
So yeah, like Christine said, the first step is mailing it to yourself, and the second step is, you know, just go online and you Google Library of Congress, and the offices are in Washington D.C. and you find out the process
by which you can download your application.
You copyright ideas.
Send it in, you know, with a copy of your work, the same thing you mail to yourself, you mail that to them, and then they'll send you back your actual copyrighted with the title of your work, and you keep that.
But then you have to have it out there.
Right.
If you're going to have a web presence or web series, your little website, make sure that your name is on everything. You can even kind of like watermark everything so that your images have a slight name on it,
mm-hmm.
just to make sure that people see it and they know that it's yours. Because people, right now, everybody copies everything else. That's a way of learning, by the way. I mean, how many Legion of ripoffs did I do when I was a teenager? So remember that stuff you're doing right now, if you really want to keep it yourself, put that little watermark on it.
Another crucial thing, and this is really important, and I know it's hard to resist, but don't tell everyone your ideas.
True.
Don't go around to all your friends telling your ideas, because then they'll come up with something 2 years later, and they'll be like, oh, you stole that from me. They might not even remember you said that.
Right.
That might just have gone in their subconscious, and then like a year and a half later, they're like, yeah.
And they think it's theirs.
And they think it's their idea. Don't go around telling people
your ideas.
Once your thing comes out, then it's out there, and you can let everyone see it. And then it's your idea, and it's legally protected, and you can share it with the world. But
we get excited every
yeah.
time.
Yeah,
we
yeah,
know
but before it's published, just...
You get excited, and you want everybody to see it, and you know, just one click away from giving your stuff away to the world.
Also, when you're pitching editors, make sure that you kind of know the editor, make sure that the person is very trustworthy. There's all this, if it's all these horror stories where you say something to an editor and 2 years later they do a book exactly like yours, but they may not remember it, or may sit in the back of their head, or they may just filed it away somewhere, and then another editor, when they quit, got that little note and they put it together. Be very careful who the editors you pick, and just, you know who you're talking to, because this is money, right? Like, coming out of your mouth is money. Your ideas, that's people, some people can live their entire life over a good idea. So you want to make sure it's there, okay?
Did anybody really try to take any of Milestone's ideas?
That's a good, not to my knowledge.
Not to a big deal.
Yeah, not to my knowledge. I mean, I imagine so, but really not to my knowledge. I mean, well, one of the things is that the Milestone stuff was legally protected to the point where I think someone knew if they were going to try and do that, there were going to be consequences. You know, now, to speak about ownership, the weird thing about the Milestone characters is that there's a copyright and there's a trademark. And so you'll see like a little TM next to something. So a trademark is like this logo, like that Superman logo, maybe trademarked or registered. There are different levels of ownership. From what I understand, the Milestone characters are owned by DC Comics, but they can't do anything with the characters without the approval of the creators.
The three remaining creators, right?
Yeah.
The family of
exactly.
And the family?
I would think the estate.
Yeah, exactly. So, right, one of the founders passed away, so his widow would probably have the responsibility of his estate. So there are different levels of ownership. There's copywriting, there's trademarking, and there's registering. What you do depends upon the type of product that you have. But to my knowledge, no one ever tried to out and out steal any of the Milestone characters' ideas. I never saw any characters in a comic book that reminded me of like Rocket or Blood Syndicate or Zombie or something.
Does any of my old school characters have any old school back rows full of kids that used to be in comic culture like 7 years ago? I know, right?
You guys are aging.
Bring up the age.
But do you have any questions for these professionals that are here? Because I'm very proud about, especially Shauna and Denise, and especially you, young lady, is that you guys are actually taking the art and working with it. I think you want to be a teacher too?
Yeah.
Yeah, so you're working there, and she's... Sean is such a good artist, and Denise is such a good artist.
Lines,
and I hope you guys get to see this stuff. It's true. But these guys are here. They kind of went to the system, and they're still in the system. Do you guys talk? Do you have any questions? Though? Anything close to that?
What would be your recommendations for starting up your own comic company in today's world?
Starting up your own comic company. Okay. First off, like seriously? Okay.
No, just pretend.
No. I mean, if we're gonna get really hardcore, it's gonna be really hard to make a profit off of creating comics. So if you're gonna do it, you have to have money that you have to be prepared to lose, both so you can get a reputation and hopefully change that. It would really be good to have investors. So if you have a business plan, and that way you can get investors, or you can look into getting business loans. Right now, I'm actually developing a webcomic with a professional writer and a professional artist who's been in the business for years. And we're going to do it on the web. And it's not about making money or anything like that. But it's just about getting the idea out there and owning it. Now, I have a job, so I can afford to do that. But really, yeah, I would say a business plan so you can get investors, and you have to be prepared to lose money for the first few years. I mean, they say that the average business doesn't break even until maybe the second or third year. But if it's like one comic book, my recommendation to you would really be to do it as a webcomic. Like a weekly webcomic, a page a week, And these days, you have Twitter, you have Facebook, so you can have your own social network, and you can have these people come back and look at your comic every week and develop an audience. And once you prove that you have an audience, like if you have a website, and let's say you can prove that you get 1 million hits a month, that's something that you can take to a company and you can say, I get 1 million hits a month. Would you be willing to invest in my website?
That's, you know, so that's what I mean by seriously above and beyond the cool ideas, the mechanics of starting a business.
I think any business that you want to go into, I suggest that you need to work in it for a minute. So interning is like invaluable. Like to go sit and learn under someone's wing. I mean, anything I wanted to do. If I wanted to open a restaurant, you know, I go work in there, whether I'm emptying garbage, but I'm watching everything that's going on. I'm trying to get, so I think that's, you know, like a first step in it.
I agree
with that, the web-based thing, just having your full vision in terms of where you want to take it, you know, like really like working on that before you even putting it out there, seeing how far this can go, you know, in your mind, and then to put that out there and follow it up.
But yeah, the internship is crucial, because again, that's how I started in. Based on working at Milestone, I got to work at DC Comics on Batman, and I remember one time I was talking to a few editors, and I had said something, and one of them looked at me, and he looked at me kind of like, how the hell do you know that?
I've got that.
And I know that because I worked at a company before that, and I was taught by people who knew that. You know, so sometimes people, you know, they may underestimate you, but you have to come in with that background. But none of that would have happened if I didn't start an internship at Milestone. I didn't walk into Milestone saying, hey, pay me, because what the hell do I know about anything? I went in there, and like I told you, like I don't know if y'all were even here yet, but I started at Milestone doing menial things, like making boxes to put mugs in to send out to
But although people. It seems menial, it was like it's a linchpin to keeping the company going, because those promotional items are going to people who are going to come back and invest and show interest in what you're doing, hopefully, you know, by sending out these promotional items. So it's like tedious work, you know, emptying the garbage, making copies. I read, but I'm copying, you know, wherever I work. And it's just information for me. It's not to divulge any of the company's business, but it's just stuff for me, for my edification. Now I learn, wow, okay, I didn't know that. At any company I go to, you know, I have my ear to the ground. I'm looking around. I'm seeing what's going on. Quiet and just absorbing it all.
Behind the scenes.
Also, homegrown stuff.
Definitely.
If you can do your own, if you keep your own stuff, right? The best thing for a person who wants to get work is to already have a little body of work already done.
Yep.
Make sure, because I see a lot of guys that have sketches and have nice little workbooks, and this is my character in this pose, and this character in this pose. Actually, show people that you can actually pull off a story. Particularly, your stuff is very nice. I want to see the stories, like, and have a book ready to go, because you never know when that opportunity comes. You can apply for grants. You can get some. Maybe some companies looking for something to advertise something else. They need to show that you can do it. And if you get the grant money and it comes in, sometimes you don't know. You apply for a grant 2 years ago and it comes in. You need to go to a printer next week. You gotta have this stuff done. A lot of cartoonists, especially young guys, they have tons of great drawings and sketches, but no work that shows that they can tell a story or write a story. Get those little stories done. Even if you have to blog it. Just get it done.
That's crucial, because nowadays, back in the days of Milestone, the way people would try to get into the business is there would be the comic book conventions and people would show their portfolios. Now, you cannot break into Marvel and DC Comics that way. Now you break into Marvel and DC Comics, they have to see that you've already done independent comics, and they say, okay, that person has proven that they can do it without us, and they have 5,000 readers. That means if we put them on the Hulk, we can increase our readership by 5,000. Once you've proven that you can do it yourself, then they will come and find you, and that's when you have some kind of power. But you go to them hat in hand, like, look at me, like, let me draw X-Men, not gonna happen.
They got me, because I already done a comic book called Tales of Closet, which I wrote the story and I even printed it myself.
Yep.
So because of that, I mean, Dwayne, remember I told you a story that nobody would go around the convention table? I was by myself, like a little bubble. He actually, one of the people, kind of was brave enough to pick up a book, and then the next year went to the convention and came looking for me. I didn't ask to be a Milestone. I didn't even know what Milestone was, but there he was. Yeah. So getting the stuff out there that people can see it, That's the way to do
and
it.
And how did you get Tales from the Closet printed as epic
characters? That was something I did on my own.
But didn't the organization...
And then after I showed it to the organization, they said, oh, let's get the money and print this out. It's really important.
What organization was this?
Hedging Martin Institute, which is the Institute for Protection of Lesbian and Gay Youth back then.
So there, in other words, you never know when where you'll get funding.
Yeah,
exactly.
Because who's going to pick up a superhero book from a book about gay teenagers? But they saw that I could do a lot of characters together and a lot of good drama.
Good story,
yeah.
And here's something that's also important, too. Like, don't do your ideas just so Marvel can find you and you can do X-Men. You have to respect your ideas more than you respect, at least as much as you respect these other ideas. Like, if you don't care about your ideas, if you don't take them as seriously as you take Iron Man, you've already failed. And if you're doing your ideas to get to Iron Man, you've already failed. Do your ideas.
Forget about Iron Man.
Exactly, exactly.
He's a product, he's already done.
Do your ideas, because your ideas are not out there and your ideas are controlled by you. Iron Man is controlled by a company, which is owned by a company. It's like when I walked in here and he was telling you about Superman or Batman. Those are products. That's why Batman doesn't age. That's why Batman can't die. They're products. Your characters can live and die and go through all these human experiences that people will respond to. So, you know, your stuff is the most important thing. Don't do it as a scam or a gimmick.
Guys, at the end, you have one last question?
Yes. Is DC or Marvel older?
I think they're about the same age. Marvel had timely comics. They did Captain America back in the 40s as well. DC had the first superhero, which is Superman, but they were printing a lot of cowboy stuff.
Wartime stuff.
DC may be slightly older, but both of them are around maybe about 80 years old.
Yeah. Okay, guys.
Yeah. All right.
How did you feel when you had to say goodbye to some of your characters?
Ivan could speak to that.
Yeah, it's, it kind of rips your heart. If you see some, it's like your baby. Can you imagine your baby comes to the movie star and they don't know you anymore? That's the way it would happen.
Wait, how come you guys lost them in the first place? Well, I know of Static, but like, how do you guys like not be remembered or considered anymore?
That's the nature of the business, that when something goes down, you know, people kind of scatter, they go elsewhere, stuff like that. There's many reasons why people leave companies. I mean, you know, I kind of burned my bridges when I left. I didn't leave in a very clean way. Guys, when you guys leave a business, don't burn your bridges, leave on good terms, you know, don't be too emotional, get your ego out of it, because you don't know how many years I regret not being talked to people that I can't even talk to anymore because of what happened back then.
Right, you never know what's going to happen around the corner. Even
people that I loved,
that
I can't talk to anymore.
Even if you're pissed off at them, don't say it. Leave like a professional. I've left companies angry, and I've worked at two companies with Jackie, and the publishing house that we worked at that I left, I had real issues, but I left clean. So I can now still talk to any of those people. Because, you know, it's not important that you know why I'm leaving. It's important that I'm leaving, and I'll just go. So just be a professional from the beginning to the end.
So can we, some people have to go because they have parking that only lasts an hour. But can we give them a round of applause for coming? This is a great thank you so much.
I can't clap.
Thank you all for coming.
If you guys want to stand around, I am going to order the pizza so everybody can eat some pizza at the same time. And if anybody wants to go to Bronx Heroes Con, it's on 165th Street Grand Concourse. You can take the 1 train or the D train. The
D train to where?
To 165th Street. 167th Street for the D train.
Oh, 167th.
Okay, you're
going to
see it's a big event. It's open till 6. So it's a lot of fun. Yeah. It's free comic book day, so we're going to have plenty of free comics for you guys.
Wait, it's free comic book day?
Today's free comic book
day. The national one?
What do you think we have this going on? This is free comic book day.
Okay.
Whoa,
wait.
I know,
you're going to
get
your
free comics for me.
So,
right, guys, can someone collect my superhero books?
Oh, these are all yours?
Yeah.
I'm sorry, ma'am. Are you over the parking?
Yeah. Oh, okay. All right, so, yes, sir.
Okay.
Here.
So, can I do something?
Thank you very much. Good job.